Well, good morning, good morning, good morning. So glad you guys are with us. And we know that there's guests with us today. A couple different ways that you can connect with us. And thank you. There was a family last week that they sent me an email to info@journey-center.com. And I just so appreciate that. We'd love to hear your feedback. Love to hear how you what God's doing in your life. Like to hear your stories. Lisa and I spend a lot of time with people that are new to their journey with us. And we love to hear the stories that people have. How many know that everybody has just an amazing story of God's goodness and his mercy and his love, right? I mean, it's just so good to hear those. So thank you for giving us an opportunity to hear your stories, because you guys are really faithful at hearing ours week after week. And I'm kind of tired of mine. I like hearing yours. So really, really good. Thanks for being here. And if it's kind of like, you know, these people are a little bit crazy around here and you have some questions of that, I just want to tell you, you're absolutely right. We are crazy around here. But we're crazy in love with Jesus, and we're crazy in love with people. And the rest of the stuff, we're just working on. Really, that's what it comes down to. We're just working on the rest of the stuff. So thank you. Thank you for risking to be here today. Really, really glad. I'm so thrilled that Jesus came to the earth. Glad to hear you are too. But the guy, he amazes me. Maybe that's why he's God. I don't know. But he amazes me in the fact that he came to the earth after his father was here and walked with us for a while, and we kind of messed that up. And then he said, "Well, okay, son, you got to go down and fix this problem that we got." And so his son shows up. And his son starts to talk about, after God's given us all these things called the commandments that we could do. Like, I mean, I think a lot of us understand that lying to somebody, that's probably not a good thing to do. Maybe nobody in here has experienced murdering somebody. That's probably a good thing, right? Killing people, that's probably a good thing. And these are things that we probably and should be able to do called the Ten Commandments. And then, you know, we like to add to those, so good people like we are. We took 10 commandments and turned them into 600 and some, right? Just to make it challenging, right? Since we can't do 10, let's see if we can do 600. That's brilliant. So here we have all this stuff, the 10 commandments that we can do that we're not doing. And then Jesus comes along and says to us, gives us these end commandments while he's here. There was 5 of them. And he says things like this: "Now, since you couldn't do what you could do, I'm going to give you some things to do that you can't do. Like this. I want you to not be afraid." Hi, buddy. "I want you to not be afraid when you should absolutely be afraid. I want you to not worry. I want you to not sin. I don't want you to doubt. But I love the one that he gave to us today, that we're going to talk about today, that I believe that most people, when they think of Christians, they think that we do this thing really well." Anybody have an idea what Christians are known for? Wow. "I thought we're known for our love. They shall know you are Christians by your judgment." Or lack thereof. And I think it's, if you've missed any of the ones that we've spoken of, we're in the fourth part or fifth part of this series. See, whenever I do a 6-part series, there's only 5 things I talk about, just in case there's one thing I missed. So we're 5th week out of 6 weeks on a 5-part series. Did you get that? Okay, good. It's kind of like a baker's dozen type of thing. But if you've missed any of those, go to journey-center.com and you can catch up on any of the not commandments that we've been talking about. But the one I want to talk about today is the one thing that we are known for and that most people don't want to know Jesus because we do this. It's called judge. Now, what we've mastered is that portion. We got that baby down. But can I tell you something? It's not just religious people. It's not just the Muslims. It's not just the Jews. It's not just the Christians that are really good at judging. I think the Republicans are doing pretty good. Democrats, they're not bad at judging. Then you got the independents that are independently judging. Conservative judgment, liberal judgment. I think this isn't a Christian problem. I think this is a people problem. How many people do we have here today? Okay, if you're not raising your hand, you need some counseling. But he says, judge not. What? 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 Can I just be honest with you today? Because it's Sunday and that's the one day a week that I'm honest. Thank you for laughing, the three that might believe that. I am really mad today that I have to be in church, aren't you? No? What about those people out there that are today? Today there are people at Disney World. That makes me mad. I'm leaking. I'm judging them right now. There are people today. You know, there's people today that are with Lauren and Joey in Philadelphia at the Block Church. And you know what? That really just makes me mad. Because I want to be there. You know, there are people that make more money than I do. That just makes me mad. How's that possible? They're ready for this? I gave an offering today, and it makes me mad that a lot of you didn't. I'm judging you for not putting any money in the offering today. But that got quiet. You know what I don't like? I don't like the fact that every time I go out to dinner that I pay. Except for when I go with Mike. But okay, so Mike, go with, right? It's like sometimes it's just like, man, you start judging things from a perspective that you have. And then like I just said, Mike could go, ha, because that's not true. But can I tell you, most things that we judge wrongly. Don't we? We judge from a perspective, we judge from a lens, we judge from a place that's not accurate. And God said this, hey son, this is how much God doesn't like judging. Hey son, I'm gonna let you be the judge. And then Jesus goes, I ain't judging. I'm coming, I'm gonna come and save them, but I ain't judging. And if we are gonna judge, hey, listen, Pop, let's work out a deal. Holy Spirit, Pop, you know, Father, God, whatever your, if we're gonna, let's work out a deal. Let's just do it one day out of all eternity. We'll call it Judgment Day. That's how much he doesn't want to do that deal. You know, anybody ever met, ready? Has anybody ever met Christians that are really excited about hell? I am. You know when I get excited about hell? Is when I know that I'm not going and you are. Do you ever have those people in your life that you go, man, I'm really glad there's a hell because they're going to get theirs. I'm serious, man. That vengeance thing, right? That they hurt me, but they're going to get theirs because there's a hell made just for people like them. Come on, somebody, right? I mean, I've had those thoughts. I'm just being straight up. That's why I'm seeing four counselors right now. And you think I'm kidding. I'm just telling you, I'm totally serious. Like, I have conversations with Dr. Barlow because I'm not understanding. There's two things I'm not understanding. Why is it I cry so much and I get broken so much every time somebody tries to take their life? Why is it every time I bury a kid, I feel like I'm burying my own? And it's like, you can't live like that. I'm getting counseling for that. Usually I call it breakfast, though. We don't call it counseling, right, Jeff? We call it breakfast, you know? It's a lot cheaper, too. Jeff, I want to meet with you. I want to pour into your life. And I get there, I go, ah! You know, it's like, but then I'm like, you know, I was thinking, I'm like, man, I feel like the Hulk. Not the bulk. I said Hulk. I feel like the Hulk, man. It's like, I feel like I'm in a constant status of angry. Wow. Why am I angry? How can I be angry? I figured out the only person in the world I'm not angry at is Ariel and Mike. And it's because Mike buys me Swiss rolls and dinner and Ariel does anything I need her to do for me. They're the only two people in the world. It's like, come on, man. How is it that I can be angry? And because you know why? Because everybody has the potential of letting you down. And my whole life, I've had this lens of being abandoned and being rejected. What? I don't know about you, but I love the fact that Jesus came and said, I get it. I was despised, I was abandoned, and I was rejected. Hey, buddy, Scott, hey, you're going to be all right. Because I overcame it, so can you. And it gives me great hope. But I don't know how you feel about, you know, judging and judging people, but I love the fact that Jesus said, do not do it. Do not do. We're Christ-like, and we have mastered the thing that he has said not to do. Isn't that interesting? So I thought I'd put it in a different word so that we can understand it. Because if we really defined judging people or judge not, it means this. This is the King James Scotty version. Thou shalt not size me up and write me off. You ever do that? Like, yeah, I don't know. Look at him. Did you hear? Did you know? Did you see what he wrote on Facebook? Did you see what she said on Facebook? Did you know that what he struck? Do you know, I had people when I, Lisa and I, we went to marriage counseling for 8 months. You know, I had people that left the church because Lisa and I went to marriage counseling. Can I just tell you something? If somebody takes their car to a mechanic, applaud them. Listen, the reason we don't fix things is because we don't know that it's broken. But when people are fixing things, when people are fixing up their house, oh, look at them. They got to paint their house. Look at their house is chipping. Look at them. How about the fact they're painting their house? That makes sense? So thou shalt not size me up and write me off. But you know why we judge people? Because we're jealous of them. You ever work for 8 hours, get paid a certain amount of money, and somebody else works for 1 hour and they get paid the same? How's that doing for you? Does anybody ever get a gift, get a really nice car, and it's better than yours? Do you celebrate that? Or is there something inside of you that goes, "Rrr"? Do you ever get mad because somebody works really hard, they steward their money really hard, really well, they give, they're very generous, and God has blessed them and they have this amazing house, and you wonder why you don't have anything? But you're not willing to be okay with the fact that they're generous, that they work hard, that they've actually invested, that they've planted seed, and that they've grown. See, what we want is jealousy says, I want what you have and I deserve what you have, even though, fill in the blank. You hearing me? You feeling me on that? We all do it. I've mastered it. Can I tell you something today? Today, I'm gonna straight up, there's some people that went camping today, and I'm mad. I'm judging them. You know why? I wanted to be camping today. Yeah, who else? Who said that? Come on, somebody, right? I gotta go to church. I gotta go to church. But jealousy keeps us from the potential of the moment. So you know what I thought of this morning? I got up and it was raining outside. I was like, I'm so glad it's raining. Yeah, they're out there. They're probably getting soaked. It's going to be a nice air-conditioned church today eating breakfast pizza. But listen. That's why we have to take all those thoughts captive. Because jealousy will always keep you away from the things that God has promised you for the day. That makes sense. Enjoy the gifts that you have. Don't compare yourself to other people. What is God doing right now? Join with what God's doing with you right now. The other thing, here's the thing, you know, I just really agree with this a lot, that if you are going to sin, you ought to make it fun. If you're sinning and it's not fun, you got to try something else. Somebody tweet that, Pastor Scott said today. Listen, the Bible says that sin is fun. For how long? For a season. All right, but can I tell you something? There's more people that plan to have fun with sin than plan to have fun with God. But do you know why that is? Because to them, we don't have fun. I'm going to tell you something straight up right now. My God loves to have fun. And he celebrates, and he loves to be with you, and he adores you. And it's like going to Christmas at Grandpa's house every single time you're with him. If you actually unpack the gifts that he's given to you right now. See, more people would plan on being in church rather than sinning if church was as attractive as sin. I think God's way more attractive. If you know the one I'm talking about, I think he's way more attractive than sin. So I built, but people say, why do you build your life around? Everything, anytime you invite us in your life, it's always about church. Actually, it's not. It's actually about him. Because it's about, man, if you want to hang out with me, I'm doing life with my family. But my family will come out with you and be with you, all right? But we'd love to invite you into our home, into our life. Because I've been there, I know you're going to like it so much more. Does that make sense? You know why I have drug problems? Because drugs give you something that people haven't yet encountered with God. But once they taste and see how good he is, drugs won't ever do anything for you. So when people are addicted to something other than him, then it's because they really haven't encountered him. Because once you encounter him, you taste and see how good he is, you can't get enough of him. Does that make sense? I think we spend a lot of time with people on focusing on their no's, not their no's, but no's, N-O, comma, S. No, no, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. Why don't we just give people a really big yes and say yes to God? Say yes to his heart, say yes to his plans, say yes to what, not because we get so distracted by all these things down here that we forget about all these offering right here. And I think the judgment allows you to not see actually what he has planned and purposed for you. Why? Well, how do I know that? Let's go. But before we get there, here's my number two reason why people judge people. Because they're self-righteous. Who are the people that Jesus liked the best? It wasn't the self-righteous. In fact, sometimes I wondered if Jesus was even a Christian sometimes he got around these guys. You know what I mean by that? If anything upset Jesus, it was people that were arrogant and self-righteous and ignorant. Well, I go to the bathroom and it never stinks. That's the can I say that? That's probably wrong. For all you visual people, I'm so sorry. Fail. I'm going to hear about that at the production meeting tomorrow. Can anybody ever know when you're around a self-righteous person? They walk around, they got that little, let me give you a picture of what a self-righteous person looks like, besides one I just gave you. You got God on a leash over here. You got people over here. And what you do is sit, God. Don't speak, God. You stay right there. I just want to make sure you're there. And that you're doing exactly what I'm telling you to do, and that you're not moving away from me, but you're right there by my side. Okay, there you are, God. Okay, so God, I want to dumb down your holiness, and I want to make sure that they all see mine. I want to make sure that they see how righteous I am. I want to see how it makes sure, and I want them to know that I'm way better than they are. Now, you may not do this consciously, but some of us have just looked at people and or had some thoughts, maybe even like, I'm glad I'm not like them. Oh, but the grace of God, there go I. Everybody ever quote that scripture? Oh, I'm just so glad I'm not like you. That's the stench of self-righteousness. And you know, the thing about people that are self-righteous is they're arrogant and they're ignorant. But the big deal about self-righteous people is, watch this. They're rarely self-aware. Do you know why people are deceived? Because they're deceived. They have no idea they're deceived. When you're under deception, you don't know that you're deceived because you're under deception. How many people know when you're deceived? If you know when you're deceived, then you're not deceived. Right? That's why we need each other. So Jesus has set up this beautiful, did I just squeak? Jesus set up this. And he says, do not judge. Do not judge. Do not judge. He goes on to say some more things, but here's the deal. He didn't put a period there. What did he put? He put a comma. Why? Because he had more to say than just do not judge. What he did have to say is, or you too will be judged. Now I want you to take your finger and I want you to point at somebody and say, do not judge or you too will be judged. Let's try this together, shall we? Do not judge or you too will be judged. Point at somebody. Come on, point at somebody. Do not judge or you too will be judged. Doesn't that feel good? That feels so good. Don't judge me. I got to tell you something. Lisa didn't hear this morning because she was out talking, I think, probably the worship team and stuff. But I listen to her and Levi in our kitchen quite often. And Lisa will say something to Levi like this. Levi, nope, not throwing you under the bus. But if I do, I'll run backwards over you too. So, just kidding. But this is, that's not even throwing Levi, really. It's just kind of, it's a fun thing. It's fun. It's all right. He won't have to go to counseling after this, I'm pretty sure. I'm going to enough counseling for him, so I don't think he'll have to. But Levi's out there, Lisa's out there, and Levi, last night we were going to have s'mores. Last night. What do you need to make s'mores? All right? You need marshmallows. Right? You need graham crackers. And you need Hershey, not just any chocolate bars. You need Hershey bars. Right? You can use Reese cups. They're pretty good too. I'm just saying. You should try one of those. They're pretty good. For all you on a no-carb diet, that's exactly what you need. You need a fire and all that. So we had a fire going. We did some chicken, you know, eating healthy, doing that whole deal. And we're going to finish off with something not healthy called s'mores. Lisa asked the question. I walk in. I think you asked me first. I think you did ask me first. Did you eat the chocolate bars? I go, no, I wasn't even in the same county as the chocolate bars when that happened. But I didn't. I didn't eat the chocolate bars. Well, then Levi comes in. There's six chocolate bars. There was six chocolate bars. So we have to go on a journey. You have to understand, we have to go on a journey with some people. And Levi's one of those people. We have to start with, Levi, did you open the Hershey bars? That's where we start. Not did you eat them all, because that's an instant list. No, I didn't. I didn't eat them. I did not eat them. So we start with, did you open them? And we work them up. We kind of just warm them up to the fact that maybe. So we got them. We got them all the way. We got them all the way to confess that he had eaten two of them. Right? Three of them? It was three gone, and we had him to confess that there was at least two. So he was two-thirds of the way not lying. Which we were really, that's good. Well, it could not have been. He could have given it to somebody else and then took it from him. Yeah. Somehow Levi worked it out. Anyways, but the point I'm trying to make about this, Levi, I hear his mom and him interacting, and this is Levi's favorite phrase. Don't judge me, mom. Don't judge me. Do not judge me, mom. Don't you judge me. And then when he gets caught in something, red-handed, busted, he's got no way out, he'll say this. Will you forgive my soul? He's got this thing down. He's got it down. Will you forgive my soul? And I pipe up, I will forgive your soul, but your butt's getting smacked. It's like, you know, we'll forgive your soul, it's okay. But boy, your flesh is going to feel this one, man. But now that it hurts more to hit him than to just let him go, we let him go. Everybody see Lee? And he's like, ridiculous, working out. Whole deal scares me. I have Dave mentoring him now. Do not judge or you too will be judged. Good word. For in the same way you judge others, story continues. You will be judged with the same measure you use. It will be measured to you. The same way that you judge others, that's how you're going to be judged. With the measure at how you judge others, that's the way that measure will be used to you. Well, when you start sizing people up, well, they're not that good. Wow, look at there. They're kind of a slacker. What is your bar that you're measuring people by? Because whatever benchmark you're measuring people by, that's the benchmark that's going to be used to measure you. Ouch. Woo. At that point, I got to join with Levi and say, judge not. I did eat the Hershey bars. Don't use that yardstick as a measure. Judge unto others. Didn't Jesus say this? Only in a different way. He said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Fill it in. Judge unto others as you would have others judge unto you. So my question is, how do you want to be judged? How do you want to be judged? How do you want to be judged? Can I answer first? I want to be judged not. But if you are going to judge me, would you please do it with mercy? Well, yes, Pastor Scott. We've heard the song, Mercy Triumphs Over Judgment. But it doesn't mean we have to do it, does it? It's just a song, right? It's just a scripture that we've read, right? Let me tell you why Jesus says not to judge. The reason he says not to judge is because we can't do it well. But here's how to do it well. If you are going to, here's how to do it well. And here's where I get a little bit vulnerable. I'm going to tell my story so that you maybe someday will be able to tell yours. If you're going to judge me, please do this. Look at the family that I grew up in. If you're going to judge me, I want you to think about the times that while I was eating Captain Crunch, that my dad said, go ahead and finish eating your Captain Crunch, dummy. Or no, fatty. If you're going to judge me, I want you to judge me understanding that when I grew up, I had acne all over my face. I had these big Coke bottle glasses. When I played baseball, to play baseball, they had to sew 2-inch strips down my pants because they didn't have pants big enough to fit me. I'd be mocked every day, bullied every day going to school because my hair, when my mom would comb my hair, I had curly hair, and when she'd comb my hair, it would look like I used a curling iron all around my head. She dressed me with, and this is, listen, back in the day, this isn't bad on my parents. I knew that I was loved. I knew that I was cared for. I knew that I was protected. They did the best they could with what they had. But my dad, when he was born cross-eyed. He was born the last child, and his parents said, you were a mistake. We didn't even want you. So as I grow up and as I'm growing out, and as I'm growing bigger, I had a 38-inch waist in third grade. And yet I still pushed, and I still wanted to play sports, and I felt abandoned, I felt rejected, and I'm from a good home. And if I'm feeling all of this, what do people have out there that didn't have good homes? I remember my mom like getting mad at me because I wouldn't clean my plate, and I'm going, brum, 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 clean your plate, clean your plate. To the point where I'd go out and I'd go out and deliver papers at 12 years old. I had my first job. I've never not worked because I felt like I had to perform. I felt I had to get people's approval. I felt like I had to earn something because I wasn't good enough. I wasn't loved. I had to earn all of that thing with God, with my dad, with my mom, with friends. It doesn't matter who it is. And now I find myself in this state in my life right now that I'm like, why am I angry all the time? Anybody watch that Narnia movie where they're like the dwarf's getting beat up, slapped by the guy, and he's going, you wonder why we don't like you. Can I just tell you something? Yeah. Nobody knows anybody else's story or shoes. Nobody else's walk. I can't expect you. Now, here's the deal. The reason that Jesus says, I'm reserving my judgment is I'm going to look at the whole story. I'm going to look at the whole picture. I'm going to look at past, present, and future because he judges accurately and he bases it upon our finished work, not our progress. Isn't that good? See, so listen, people judge. This is just straight up honest. Rick, I've had him since he was 14 years old. Paul Fernie, same way. Dave King, since I was 17 years old. When you know somebody's life, when you know the journey they've been on, when they know the different things that they've encountered and had to deal with, you can judge much more accurately when you know what they've been through. Does that make sense? So here's the deal. If somebody's acting out being a butt head, got to save myself on that one. But when they're acting out, if they're being a jerk, it's probably because there's so much pain sitting there. There's so much of a past. You don't know what their life. Because listen, everybody was born. That's my Italian side coming up. Everybody was born as a baby, a beautiful baby. Yeah. Hitler was born a beautiful baby. Osama bin Laden was born a beautiful baby. Created in the image of God. But something happened. We got conform to something that he said would kill us. It's called sin. Does that make sense? So when you look at somebody, when you look at what, why are they this? You know, the big deal right now is transgender. Do you know how many people don't know who they are? Do you know how many people don't know who they are? They don't know where they came from. They don't know where they're going. They don't listen. I don't want a guy in the bathroom with my 6-year-old daughter. Straight up honest. Just gonna tell you straight up, and I'll make sure that doesn't happen. But at the same time, there's this tension we have to manage that there are a whole lot of people that have an identity crisis that's out there, a whole lot. So what would Jesus do in that situation? And I'm gonna tell you what he'd do. He would judge not. While doing what? Protecting. That makes sense? There's a model, there's a setup that he has. He says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye? Can I just focus on this for a minute? Why do you look? Why are you consumed with what's wrong with somebody else? Why is it so easy? I don't know how this works for you. I am masterful at seeing what's wrong with other people. Masterful. I can tell you, come up to me, you want prayer, I can stand here and tell you everything that's wrong with you. I'm good at it. Really good. That's why I made a good engineer. But what I've had to learn is to take these same eyes and see not what's wrong, but to see what is right. And we can become as masterful at seeing what's right with people as we are at seeing what's wrong with people. See, because if that transgender person, if that, whatever, name it, that the addict, whatever, you can put it, the adulterer, the pornographic consumer, you can put that in any place. But here's the deal: the reality is that every single one of them were created in the image of God. They just have forgotten who they are. That's the truth. In every case, when I'm behaving in ways that are inappropriate in revealing who he is, I'm stepping out of my identity and doing things I shouldn't have done. Because I'm not, my wife always said, that's not who you are. Don't do that. That's not who you are. You don't have to think that way. Why? It brings me back to remembering who I am. Does that make sense? 2, 3, 4 heads. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? Has anybody ever had anything in their eye? How many would like some? We got ushers have sand right now. We're like to come around and just drop one single speck of sand into your eyeball. How does that feel? Can I just tell you what it feels like? It feels like you're going to have a speck in your eye. Or no, excuse me. It's going to feel like you have a plank in your eye. Right? Am I right? I'd like to propose to you that when you're looking at other people's problems, I didn't say this morning, this is just coming to me right now, but when you're looking at other people's problems, you look at them as a little speck. Like, what is wrong with you? But when you recognize that there's a problem in your life, how big does that speck feel in your life? Oh, no one knows what I'm going through. Oh, no one understands what I, oh, no. And can I just be honest with you? Because on Sundays, I try to be honest. I can never see a plank or a speck in my own eye unless I'm looking in a mirror. And very few of us are willing to look in a mirror. Why? Because we're not willing to be self-aware. And I got to warn you about something about self-awareness. It's the scariest thing I've ever done. It may be one of the most hurtful things I've ever done. I've never had a problem with finding out what's wrong with you. I can deal with that and help you walk through it. But finding out the planks in my own life have been the most devastating things I've ever had to deal with. But the beauty about it is that Jesus is saying here, he goes, listen. I know that you're seeing a speck, and I get it. I see that too. I know that everybody has problems. Everybody has issues. But here's the deal. I need you to pay attention to that which is in your eye. Can you do that first? This is the first order of business. And he goes on. He says, how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You can't really help him until you take care of your issue. Why do you think it is that Jesus had to deal with everything that you and I could possibly deal with, and he overcame it? Why? Because he modeled something for us that now I dealt with all this stuff. I can show you a way to deal with yours. Do you know that most of the times we are seeing things wrong with other people is because we have the same issue ourselves or stronger? We get angry at people for the very same things that we struggle with. Most pastors and most preachers will actually preach years on one topic because it's something that they struggle with. You know, most people, sorry, Jeff, I'm not going to go, what do we do? We go to counseling school, and we go to psychology, we become pastors, we do all of this stuff. I watched the movie Captain America yesterday. Yesterday we took the kids. And one of the things they said about Starks, which they called him Stank. Yeah. And they delivered the thing, Mr. Stank instead of Mr. Starks. Anyways, that was pretty funny. But he goes, I give away so much of my money because I'm trying to make up for all the guilt I have. See, so many people, so many times, we focus on something for so long because we're trying to make up for something. We're trying to fix in other people things that really hurt us or things that really destroyed us or things that we've really struggled with. And so I want to encourage you that the big deal about this is God does want you to help other people, but it's not first. Watch. He called them hypocrites. See, this is God's definition of a hypocrite. When you're more concerned about other people's problems than you are your own. Uh-oh. Lesson number one, mind your business. You mind your business, you mind your business, I'll mind my business because I know my insecurities, I know my hurts, I know my pain. Is that what Jesus was saying? No. You hypocrite, first. If he's saying first, that gives you the idea that there might be a second. This side said it. I'm going to try over here. Joe, help me out on this side. If there's a first, there might be a second. Right, second. He said, first, take the plank out of your own eye. Prerequisite to helping anyone, take the plank out of your own eye, which means you got to look in a mirror, and a great mirror is the Word of God. And then you will see clearly. How many want to see clearly? Why do you want to see clearly? Well, because if I help somebody else with their plank, then I'm going to be able to get to see clearly. I'm going to be able to hear the revelation, the wisdom of God, and I can just, it betters me. Huh? You have bettered me because you have problems, and I recognize those problems. And because you had problems, I recognize problems in my life, and now I'm a better person. Thank you very much, but I'm not going to help you. That's as dumb as a box of rocks, not chocolates, rocks. It says, lesson number two, when I'm tempted to pass judgment upon thee, King James Version, because it rhymed, I should stop and check for traces of me. If I'm looking at you, I better first look at me. So first one is mind your own business. Second one is by you having mistakes, then I can fix me. See you later, Charlie. Is that what he said? No. He says, you hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So the end of this is, Jesus is saying, remember when I told you to love one another? What does love demand? This is why I'm saying not to judge. You're to be known for love, which is much harder, much more difficult, much more challenging, but it is the thing that works. Love one another. Because why? Because you'll find out that when you choose love, love forbids you to size people up and write them off. I don't like the way you are. You're not like me. I like everything about you that looks like me. We always want people. That's why we have denominations, you know. Because everybody looks the same, smells the same, walks the same, works the same, prays the same, believes the same. As long as you're all the same, I'll like you. But if you're different, I don't want anything to do with you. This weekend, we're going to go and love on the veterans of our community. We're doing this thing called the Camo Fest. We decided to partner with these guys because they are loving on a whole bunch of people that back in the Vietnam War, we didn't love them when they came home. And I think right now, a lot of the veterans feel like we don't love them now. I think they feel like they've been forgotten. Well, this weekend, we're going to remember them very well. We're throwing, with a guy that brought it to us, we're throwing a festival. You know how we've done for iMatter? Well, now we're doing it for the veterans this weekend. Same place, same time, Sunday, next Sunday, 1 o'clock at the fairgrounds. And somebody asked me, it says, is this a Christian festival? And we emphatically said, no. But everyone who's running the festival on our side of things love Jesus with all their heart. So we're taking our reach team, we're taking our School of Supernatural Ministry, we're taking leaders from here, and you're all invited. In fact, you're invited to sign up today out here. We're going to go, and you can do any job there except for clean up the garbage. That's going to be Pat Janiak's and mine and Matthew's job this year. We're going to clean up the garbage for the veterans. But I think actually we're cleaning up the garbage for Jesus. And so we're going to go there, and this band called Firehouse is playing. Anybody? They're a great worship band. If you don't know that? No, they're not. They're a classic rock band. In fact, no band that's there is going to be Christian. None. Zero. You know what else they're going to do? They're going to be serving beer there. I got people saying, you know, it seems like you're a friend of sinners. And I say, I am. I'm indeed a friend of sinners. Yeah, you ever met some people? In fact, I are one of these once in a while. You ever meet people that are really glad there's a hell? Come on. We talked. Right. There was this guy named Rob Bell, about 2010, 2011, wrote a book called Love Wins. In the book, he tried to say in the New Testament, tried to find a way that he said, there's no hell. You know how many people came to me and was like, I can't believe this pastor saying there's no hell. I can't believe I didn't really have an answer. I'm like, oh, you know, the poor guy, you know, he's just crazy, you know, whatever. I didn't know what to say. But you know, I'm going to tell you what I would say now. If somebody asked me, what do you think about this book? What do you think about this concept that there's no hell? You know what I'd say? I'm going to say it to you right now. I hope he's right. Don't you? I hope he's right. See, because, listen, if any one of you say, no, I hope he's wrong, you got to go get counseling. None of us should ever want, Jesus said this, I don't want anyone to perish. If you have it in your heart, I'm glad there's a hell. I'm so glad there's a hell. What the hell's wrong with you? No, I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. Please, somebody, I did not say that on the World Wide Web. I did not. But come on, we can't think that way. The reality is this. If you believe that there is a heaven and a hell, then you should be acting that way. Because if there is a hell, then we should act like we don't want anybody to go there. So don't tell me what your theology is if you're not doing anything to keep people out of hell. Don't argue with me what I believe. I'm going to tell you right now, the love of God, not hell, propels me to keep them from that hell, because hell is not meant for any single human being. Hell is meant for the enemy and for the fallen demons, but hell is expanding every day because of the fact of the lack of righteousness in our land that will keep people from going there. People that are going to hell have no idea that they're going to hell. Does that make sense? This is a big deal. So here's the deal. If you do believe that there is a heaven and a hell, which the Bible's really clear on that, if you do believe that, then live your life in such a way that you want people to go to the right place. But more than that, what if they could experience heaven right here, right now? Heaven isn't just a place we're supposed to be going to. Heaven is this place that's supposed to come to us. Why do I know that? Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. There's a kingdom that is to come, and there is a kingdom that is now. And people need to experience him now to know that there's a place prepared for them that wait on him. Does that make sense? So I've been dealing with, listen, you guys are just hearing all the stuff that I've been dealing with internally in myself, but I think it's about time that we actually care about. And I love the fact, yesterday when we were down there with Jeff and Tracy at the Transformation Center, I love the fact the way things, that there's a group of people, what you guys are doing, you know, over at Fusion. I mean, all of our city is becoming alive. What Adam is doing at Turtle Leaf Cafe, what's happening with Travis and Cindy at Journey Fitness, what's going on at the iMatter House, what's going on with what Jeff and Trace are doing in their counseling, what's going on at the community center. The city of Elmira is changing, not just because people are singing Kumbaya. It's not just because people are saying, well, I'll pray for you. Love what you're doing. God bless you. You keep doing it. Keep doing it. We'll cheer you on. Stinking Mark and, not stinking Mark and Bauer. A hamburger, a hot dog, a cup of water in the name of the Lord, man. Don't tell me about your theology. Show it to me. Jesus said this when he went away. He said, listen, I want you to teach them to observe everything that I've commanded you. Wow. Love forbids me to size you up and walk away. Don't size people up and then leave them in the status they're in. Don't leave them there. Take the plank out of your own eye in preparation for removing the speck from your brother's eye. Come on, let's do the hard work. Let's get a sozo done. Let's get counseling done. If we need to go through deliverance, if we stop being tormented from things, whatever, do you need prayer? You need counseling? Whatever, just do the work. Let's remove the planks out of our own eye, because there's a whole bunch of people that need healthy whole people so that they can become healthy whole people. Don't just let it stop here. Don't let it be an academic experience. Let it be a heart change. There's a world that's dying to know Jesus, the Jesus that you and I have been privileged to know, but they're not going to know him unless they see him, unless they observe him in action, not just in words. So you size people up, you write them off. Big way to change that is let the sin of others break your heart. But probably the reason the sin of others isn't breaking your heart is because you haven't allowed your own sin to break your heart. Ah, God, the more I see this stuff, man, and it's not a fun journey, but it's a good journey. The more I see the stuff in me, it helps my heart break for others that are struggling with the same things. And the more freedom that I experience and the more freedom that I taste, the more freedom I know there is available for them. You might be a person who sizes people up and then you walk away. Hey, that's their business, you know. I'm going to go ahead and work on me, let them work on them. Stop doing that. Jesus says, you see clearly now that the plank is gone. And if you have a hard time with this during the week, just remember and sing this song. I can see clearly now the plank is gone. That's going to stick with you all week long. That is, you know. As soon as you start judging somebody, I can see all obstacles disappear. Nah, don't let me. Let me sing your song, God. I don't want to ever stand in judgment of somebody else. I haven't been in their shoes, man. I want to love them, though, because I know that love actually will change everything, everything, everything that needs to be changed. Maybe you've been sized up, though. Hey, listen. You guys, everybody listen to this one. Here's the deal. This is a really, really, really big deal. Everybody right here, right now. Maybe you've been sized up, and maybe somebody wants to love you, maybe somebody wants to father you, but you're not willing to listen. I'm going to give you one warning. Defensiveness ensures that your past will continue to show up in your future. If you're not willing to be teachable, to humble yourself by people who generally have removed planks from their eyes, and now they're trying to help you remove your speck. If you stay in a defensive posture and you don't receive it, you can do that, but you'll ensure that your past will always continue into your future. So if you want your future to change, then get off of the insanity wheel and start to listen to the reason and the wisdom and the revelation of the Father spoken through men and women who have heard from the Father, because they've removed their own planks out of their eyes. And you'll know who they are because they bring it in humility and gentleness and kindness. But please, don't be that person that stays in your past any longer. So if you are any one of these three audiences, maybe you size people and you write them off. That's been me. In fact, I did that today. If you're that kind of person that sizes people up and then say, I just don't want nothing to do with them, I can't help them, they're on their own, I've tried, I'm done. That's been me. And if you're this person that when other people are trying to help you and they have sized you up and they've seen the speck and they've removed their own plank and they've had victory in their lives and they're trying to speak into your life, don't be the one that shuts them down because you don't want to get stuck in a past that has no future. That's been me. But thank God. Thank God. Thank God for the grace and the love and the kindness of Jesus that has helped me turn having a mind that was not transformed into one that's being renewed. Because when you start to have a renewed mind, you actually come into agreement with his mind and his thoughts. So I want to pray for you. If you're any one of those three, let's just do that thing. I'm going to put my hand up first. But I want to pray for all of you. Any one of those three, put your hand up. Any one of those three. Father, you see the honesty. See, here's a big deal. Self-awareness. A self-righteous person will never be self-aware, or rarely. Being aware of a problem isn't the problem. Not being aware of the problem is the problem. So, Father, with every issue that we have, every struggle that we're encountered with, everything, every trap that we give ourselves to, I pray, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, that as we're self-aware of the problem, that it doesn't stop there. We're not under condemnation. We're not under that guilt or that shame. That's broken off in Jesus' name. But what we are under is under the grace, the kindness, and the love of God that actually will compel us into having a different way of thinking. And I pray for every single person in here that we move into a walk of repentance, a walk of love, a walk of grace, a walk of mercy, that we follow your Holy Spirit's leading with everything that we're encountering. There's a purpose, not just for us to come up higher, but to bring others up higher. In Jesus' name I pray, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Everyone in agreement with that, we say amen. Let it be done. Let's stand together, worship one more time. Tony's going to come, give us some final thoughts, and then we're going to worship one more time.